walking on. Hear something up ahead, water falling like a song. An everlasting stream, your river carries me home. Let it flow, let it flow. All my fountains a flood for my soul, a well that never will run dry. I've rambled on my own, never believing I would find an everlasting stream. Your river carries me home. Let it flow.
You're here this morning, and we want to welcome you this time of worship. We're glad you're here. Hope that you're glad to be here this morning. And as we get ready to for a time of worship, let me just mention a few things real quick. Tonight, 4 o'clock meeting, deacons meetings at 4 this evening. Some of you saw an announcement about Raceway Ministries meeting tomorrow night at Darlington First Baptist at 6, but that meeting has been canceled because they received word that we are not going to be able, the racetrack will not let them set up the Raceway Ministry tents this year like we've done in the past. So just letting you know, that's they just got that word late in the week. So again, just be praying there, you know, about that. We just have to be able to get the word out in other ways besides going out to the racetrack. But anyway, be in prayer there. Just, you know, thinking about next Saturday, our prayer walk that we're meeting here at the church a little bit before 9 o'clock next Saturday morning in the Family Life Center. And then we will go out for our prayer walk next Saturday morning and be praying for our kids. And next Sunday morning during the worship time, we will be praying over our teachers and children that are preparing to go back to school. So just want to mention a few things there that are coming up. And Mike, is there anything else we need to mention? All right. Well, would you join me and let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you so much, Lord, that you have continued to work in our lives. You're making us to be more like you. Lord, it's just awesome to think that you loved us so much that you would give up the glory of heaven to come and rescue us, come to be with us. And Lord, we thank you. We praise you this morning. Lord, we just pray as we worship in this place today that the name of Jesus may be high and lifted up, that you will be glorified, Lord, and that, Lord, we will hear you speaking to us. Father, give us clear hearts and minds to concentrate on you this morning and to lift you up as we praise you in this place today. Lord, we love you, and we just want to thank you for this time. We ask, Lord, you bless us with your presence. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 40 talks about that God lifted me up, that I waited on the Lord. And as the words of this song says, I waited and he heard my cry. So I'm going to ask you to stand, if you would, as we sing this song. It talks about waiting upon the Lord. It goes like this. I waited for the Lord on high. I waited and he heard my cry. I sing to let the people know that I have been restored, and they will kneel and understand to return and trust in the Lord. I waited for the Lord on high. I waited and he heard my cry. Waited for the Lord on high.
from fear into security, from quicksand to a rock. I waited for the Lord on high. I waited and he heard my cry. I
comes to us and brings us just in the nick of time. He brings us and he rescues us. It's all because of Jesus. All because our Heavenly Father reached down and met us where we were. What the name of Jesus is, it's above all every other name.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now?
What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin.
Heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Father, we thank you this morning that there is no name greater than the name of Jesus. That there is no name greater. And Lord, we realize this morning how much we need you. And how how great the name of Jesus is. It can meet every need that we have. And we praise you, Lord.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a
so thankful that you have come to worship with us at Kelleytown Baptist Church. Just so excited to be here again and to have the opportunity, the privilege to worship the Lord. And so we want to welcome you. If you are a first-time guest with us, I don't think there are, but if you are a guest, we would love to know that you are here worshiping with us today. And if you would take just a moment, sometime now after the service, sometime this afternoon, but go on to our website at kelleytown.org, and there on the front page is a link. It's called Connect Card, and you can click on that, and it will let you send us just your name, maybe an email or something along those lines. But we'd just love to have a record of your attendance. thank you for coming to worship with us today. Before Sam comes to sing a beautiful song and then I preach, I wanted us to spend some time praying. These 73 backpacks, and we've got some for kindergarten all the way through fourth grade that will be going to Bay Road Elementary. I think we're taking them this week there, but these represent 73 kids, 73 homes, but a lot of others as well. That's just one school, and this probably isn't all the kids, but it's what we were able to put together. So I'm so thankful for the way that you have given and helped support that so that we could help these kids. And we are looking at ways to partner with the schools here in our community. And what I want the relationship with us to be with the schools in our community is, look, we can't do everything, but here's what we want you to feel free to do. That's ask. And we just, if we can do it, we'll do it. If we can't, I hope that you understand. We may be able to help you find somebody that can do it, but we want to have that type of relationship in our community with our schools, with our teachers, and with our students, that if you need something, we want to be a place that you look for help. And so I'm so thankful. But what I wanted to do was to spend some time praying over these backpacks and what they represent and who they will be going to this year. And so if you feel comfortable this morning, I would invite you just to come and gather around the altar, and we're just gonna to pray over these. If you want to kneel down and kind of lay hands on some of them, that would be fine. If you don't, you can pray where you are, but if you feel comfortable, I would invite you to do that now and us just pray over these bags. It's so important that we be the hands and feet of Jesus, and so thank you for doing that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you, and we know that our world is a broken place. We know that it is full of broken people. And Lord, we don't know the circumstances of the kids and the homes, the families that are represented by these backpacks, but we lift them up today. God, there are people with genuine needs and genuine limitations in their life, and you've called us to minister to them. God, you've called us to represent you to them. And so, Lord, I pray that these backpacks would be received well and that they would be used as they were intended. God, that it would just be a blessing to those students, those families, and ultimately those teachers. Lord, we know that so many teachers just on a week in and week out take out of their own pocket to buy stuff that their kids need that their families cannot provide for them. And so, Lord, I pray that we can come alongside the teachers and the schools and help in those situations, not just at the beginning of the year, but it would be something that would be an ongoing relationship. God, you have blessed us immensely here at Kelleytown Baptist Church. And Lord, we want to be good stewards of all the resources that you have given us. And I'm so thankful for the heart of this church to want to reach out into our community to do things like this that make a difference. But God, if we meet physical needs and never address the spiritual needs of these kids, then we've missed the mark. Because God, you didn't come and make a way for us to give backpacks and school supplies. You came so that we could share the love of Jesus, so that we could share the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ and redemption and forgiveness and salvation. And I pray that in ways that we can this coming year, like participating in the Good News Bible Clubs on a weekly basis. And God, there's just so many different ways that we can be your hands and your feet and share your voice so that these kids can hear the gospel. And I pray that we would see heaven filled, eternity altered because of us doing something like this as an initial step this year in reaching out to our community. And so we just thank you again for the opportunity. I pray that we would be found faithful. We love you, Lord. We thank you for loving us the way that you do. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine, yeah, I can only imagine, I can only imagine, I can only imagine, I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Well, I pray that you are well, and that you are doing well. One of my favorite commentators, and I have mentioned this before, is Dr. Warren Wiersbe. And I can't say I have all of his books, but I have most of them. And he's a very profound writer, but yet puts everything on a shelf that most anybody can read and understand and gain from. And so I would encourage you to grab some of his books. He's written books on most every book in the Bible, and so it will be a great asset to you as you read and study. But as I was listening to him, I got to hear him preach numerous times at different conferences. But one time that I heard him preach, I'll never forget it. He was later in life. He's gone on to be with the Lord now, but he was speaking, he was preaching out of the book of Psalms, and he said, if I could go back and do my ministry all over again, he said, I would spend my life studying the book of Psalms. He was like, I've studied it a lot later in life, and he's like, I just never realized how rich the book of Psalms is. And as we are doing our read through the Bible in a year, right now we are in the midst of Psalms. And I was reading this week, actually yesterday, and with everything that's going on in our world and everything that seems to be ramping back up, I want to let you know that we are taking the new news of this COVID variant as seriously as we can, and we're going to begin to clean like we were doing between services and stuff like that. We're going to do everything that we can to maintain as safe and clean an environment here at the church as absolutely possible. So I wanted to let you know that that's what we're going to be doing. So as soon as the service is over, if you will exit the room as quickly as possible, our deacons are going to grab the fogger and start fogging and make sure that everything is good. So that's going on. And you have to do for yourself what you think is best, and I understand that, and we'll just continue to serve the Lord as we can. There are a few things like cleaning and that kind of stuff that we can be proactive in as we move forward in the days ahead, but there's a lot of things, Brother Manley Kelly and I were talking about it yesterday, and there's just a lot of things that it's just going to continue to be a day by day, and as we get information, we'll make the best decision that we can based on the information that we have at that time. So we're paying attention, and we're doing all that we can. But I said that because before I preach, there's something I just want to remind you of. In Psalm 62, listen to what the Bible says in verse 1. My soul waits in silence for God only. From him is my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold. I shall not be greatly shaken. Then you drop down to verse 5. My soul wait in silence for God only, for my hope is from him. He only my salvation, my stronghold. I shall not be shaken. In the first verse, or in the second verse, he says, I shall not be greatly shaken. As he worships and he celebrates, he gets down, and at the end of verse 6, I shall not be shaken at all. Why? Because he's reminding himself of where his hope is. And I don't know what your position is on the vaccine and that kind of stuff. Folks, the vaccine is not your hope. Jesus is. A government solution is not your hope. Jesus is. The government can't save you. Only Jesus can save you. So as we go through life and we face these circumstances, whatever they may come, just remind your soul, remind your heart, remind your mind over and over again of where your help comes from. God is our salvation. He goes on God, my salvation and my glory rest. The rock of my strength, my refuge, is in God. And I love what he says in verse 8. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. I don't know what the days ahead hold. I don't know what's going to happen from a day-to-day moment. But this is what I do know. One day, and it's closer than it's ever been, Jesus is coming back. That's our hope. He is not only our salvation, and he's not only our eternity. He is our present. The Bible says that he is a very present help in time of trouble. Amen? And so as all this comes out, and there is there are decisions that are being made, and there is a tendency in a circumstance like this to be afraid, there's a difference in being careful and being afraid. There's a difference in being wise and being afraid. We have nothing to fear. Amen. Death is our ticket home. If that's the worst that happens. Melissa and I were talking about this the other day, and that's the reality. It's not that I'm looking to get on the next train. You know, it's kind of like that the preacher was preaching about going to heaven. Are you ready to go? How many of you are ready to go to heaven? And people would raise their hand, and he was wanting 100% participation out of that exercise. And there was one guy, and he would not raise his hand. And after like three or four attempts, the preacher said, "Brother," and he called his name, "do you not want to go to heaven?" He was like, "Sure I do. I just thought you was getting up a trip now." Right? But don't we want to be home? Home. That old saying, home is where the heart is. And I don't know about you, but my home is not here. My home is in heaven. Man, I can't wait to go home. I'm satisfied. I'm content to be here as a stranger and an alien and a foreigner as long as God wants. But I'm ready to go home. Amen. And so what's coming? What's coming? What are the coming attractions? What does the Bible have to say as all of these things begin to unfold? And as we move forward, I believe at a rapid pace, a pace that I never believed that I would see in even my lifetime. The things that are happening and the way that people are being conditioned to believe whatever the leaders of our world have to say. So, Pastor Mike, why would you put it that way? Because that's what exactly has to happen. Because there's going to come a day, and the text that we're going to use as a springboard for the message today, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18, talk about the event that put all of that into motion, and there are going to be millions and millions of people all over this world that vanish. And there are going to be all kinds of questions about those disappearances and where did they go, and they're going to be people who are going to show up at this church the next Sunday after that happens. You know, the sad thing is there'll be some people here to let them in. But they're going to have heard. They're going to know what the Bible has said. They're going to have grown up in what we would declare as Christian homes, and yet they had a religion. They had an idea. They had head information about Jesus, about salvation, about repentance, and about forgiveness, but it was never personal for them. They had religion, but they didn't have a relationship. And remember, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, there are going to be many who will stand before me on that day. What day? The great white throne judgment day. And they will say, "Lord, Lord, didn't we preach in your name? And didn't we teach in your name? And didn't we evangelize in your name? And didn't we prophesy in your name? And didn't we do good works and serve the poor and the community in your name?" And he will say to them, what? "Depart from me. I never knew you." See, it's all about relationship. It is literally all about who you and I know. And if you don't know Jesus, you will spend eternity in hell. That is what is coming. But let me ask you this question. Why, in light of all that's going on, And in light of all of the information that is being bombarded by us, why would we choose to believe the Bible? Why would we choose to believe? Stand with me in honor of the reading of God's word. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. This is the passage of scripture that I use almost every time I do a funeral. And I do the graveside service, I remind the people that are there before me of what this text says. Beginning in verse 13 of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, this is what the Bible says. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep. What a precious way to look at Christians who have died. You don't know why? Because one day they're getting up. One day that body is coming up out of the ground. Why do I believe that? Because that's what the Bible says. But what a beautiful picture that they are not even dead. They are just asleep. Why does he not want them to be uninformed about Christians who have died? So that you will not grieve as do the rest who have no hope. The Bible doesn't say that there will be no grieving. It just says that because of the hope we have in Jesus, we won't grieve the same way as people who have no hope grieve. What a blessing. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. May God add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word. Father, we pray that you would speak. God, we know that you're here. And we know that your word is alive. It's quick and it's powerful and it's sharper than any two-edged sword. Take it as the master, as the great physician, and wield it in our hearts and in our minds, in our lives, so that we will leave this place more like Jesus than when we came in. And I pray that our faith would be strengthened today. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Thank you. And you can be seated. Why believe? Why? The reason that I chose this passage of scripture, and it's a springboard. We're going to come back in a couple of weeks, and we're going to focus on this passage of scripture specifically as we look at the rapture of the church. But I want to lay a foundation, because there are all kinds of ideas. There are all kinds of perspectives. As a matter of fact, if you went out onto the streets of Hartsville and you asked the first 10 people that you came up to what they think about the Bible, you're going to get probably 10 different answers, but they're all kind of going to kind of be rooted probably in this. It's a good book, the Bible. It's a good book, but I'm not sure if it's God's book. There's a lot of doubts. There's a lot of confusion. There's a lot of misunderstanding about God's word. One of the sad realities is that a growing number of people who are in the church, not this church, but churches far, far away from here, right, that believe that the Bible contains God's word, but that it's not God's word. You see the difference? What they're saying is that there are parts of it that they believe might be God's word, and there are parts of it that cannot be because of what it talks about. And so then they say, well, how do you determine what's God's word and what's not? Well, I don't know. Well, then, man, you're in a mess. And that is a growing group of people in the church. In churches just like this all across our country and all around our world, there is a growing group of people who don't believe what the Bible has to say, and they call themselves Christians. So why believe? What is a reason that I can give you today to help you believe what God's word has to say about the future. Because some of the stuff that we're going to look at over the next months, and the pictures that the Bible paints about things that are to come, are almost unbelievable. When we think about all of that we're going to, it's almost unbelievable. The only reason why I believe it is because God said it. God said it. That settles it. Amen. And so I want us to be encouraged today. I pray that your faith and your belief is strengthened today. And so what I want to do is I want us to take a historical journey through the scripture just to be reminded of this one truth. God makes promises, and God keeps his promises. The first promise that I want us to look at this morning is the promise that God made to Adam and Eve. We know the story of Genesis 1 and the creation of all things. Why do we believe that when the world says that we're crazy to believe it? Because we see God's handiwork, we see God's hand, we see the order and the process by which it's impossible to come to even over billions and billions of years. I remember one of my favorite professors, Dr. John Ewart, was telling us a story in our doctoral program, and long story short, he was the first to be saved out of generations of lostness, grew up in Oklahoma, and his brother and his sister were both atheists, and his brother went to be a medical doctor and a surgeon. His sister was a bigwig lawyer there in Oklahoma, and he got saved and went into the ministry, and his family wasn't really thrilled about that. But his brother called him one day while he was in the midst of his medical studies, and his brother was just bawling his eyes out, and he's like, "Man, what's going on?" And he's like, "I just got saved." And he's like, "What? You just got saved?" He's like, "Yeah, I was in the lab, and I was dissecting the human hand. And as I looked at the human hand and the complexity of the human hand, I knew that that could never happen in a process of evolution. And if it's not something that evolved over millions and billions of years, then that means that there had to be someone who designed it that way, created it that way, and built it that way. And the only person that could do that is the God of the Bible." So he got saved by dissecting the human hand. So we can know there is proof. Romans 1 tells us that there is evidence all around. If we will just look at it with an objective eye, we will see the handiwork and the hand of God. God, in Genesis 1, the Bible says, made Adam with his own hands, in his own image, and then he breathed life into Adam, and man came to be. And he put him in the midst of the garden and said, "Take care of it, manage it, I've given it, do whatever you want to, but don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For in the day that you eat of it, then you will die." And Adam looked around. He saw all that God did. He was working. He named the animals. He saw that there was two of every kind. There was a male and a female. And he looked around and said, "Well, where's one like me?" And God said, "It's not good for man to be alone." And he put Adam to sleep, took one of his ribs, and formed Eve out of that rib, and gave her to Adam as his helpmate. And it was Adam's responsibility to teach Eve what God had said. And in some way he did it, but he didn't do it effectively or correctly. I don't know, because the Bible says that after all of that, Adam and Eve are in the garden, and Satan shows up in the form of a serpent and has a conversation with Eve. Adam is present, and he manipulates and ends up deceiving Eve and convincing Eve that God's holding out on them, right? And he convinces Eve to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and Adam sat back and watched, and Eve didn't die that he could tell. And the Bible says that Eve handed him the fruit and he ate of it too. And in that moment, they were both aware that they were naked and they were ashamed of their nakedness. And they went and hid and they tried to cover themselves up, and then God showed up. And the Bible says God kept his promise. He kept his promise that if they ate, he would judge them for their disobedience and they would die. And they did. They died on the inside first, spiritually. And over a period of time, their body decayed. And ultimately, the Bible says that Adam and Eve died physically too. God kept his promise to them about that. But God made a promise in the midst of his pronouncing his judgment. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, God says, I'm going to send someone to fix forever what you destroyed. Remember, he said, I'm going to send someone, and he's going to bruise his heel, but he will bruise his head. He's talking about the cross. He's talking about Jesus, and that although Jesus died on the cross, in the end, it was only like getting wounded on the heel. And yet in that same moment, as Satan thought that he was victorious, his head was crushed. And he is a defeated foe. God kept his promise. Why? Because God is always, always faithful. We see that God did that in Matthew chapter 1 and in Luke chapter 2. There you find the story of the birth of Jesus. God had promised. Thousands of years have passed. And at the right time, just according to God's plan, the way he had set all of that in motion, Jesus was born of that virgin Mary. God kept his word. Folks, we can believe what the Bible says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 through 18, that one day Jesus is coming and he's going to take us home to be with him, and the dead in Christ aren't going to miss out on what was going on, because that was one of their concerns in Thessalonica, was these people that died with their faith in Jesus, are they going to miss out because Jesus didn't come back before they died? And Paul said, absolutely not. As a matter of fact, Jesus is going to raise them up before we who are alive and remain get caught up. It's going to happen in the twinkling of an eye. It's going to happen so fast, you're not going to realize it till it's done. But he's going to raise them up. Why do we believe that? Because God, from the very beginning, kept this promise. He kept his promise to Adam and Eve. He kept his promise to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. We're introduced to Abraham in Genesis chapter 11, in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. And then again, the promise is repeated in Genesis chapter 15, verses 1 through 6. God said, Abram, if you'll follow me, I'm going to take you to a land that's flowing with milk and honey. And not only am I going to give you a land, but I'm going to make you the father of nations. And your descendants are going to be like the sand of the sea and the stars in the sky. And I'm going to bless all the world through you. And God did that for Abraham and for Isaac and for Jacob and for the Jews. And he blessed the world through them. How did he do that? Because it was through Jacob's son, Judah, that ultimately Jesus was came. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. God simply made a promise about a piece of land in the Middle East to a group of people that he formed. God's chosen people. And there are some promises that God made to those Jews about that land that I believe are still to come to fruition. I believe that he made a promise and he is going to rule and reign. The Bible says, and we're going to look at this later on down the road, about the millennial reign of Christ, that 1,000 years where Jesus is going to rule and reign the Jews and the world from Jerusalem as King of the Jews. Remember, because even when Pilate accused him, are you the King of the Jews? Jesus didn't deny it. Jesus said this, it is as you say. In other words, yep, but my kingdom hadn't come yet. I'm not here as king right now. but I'm coming back. I'll be back. And so God kept his promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. God made a promise to Hagar. Y'all remember the story of Hagar? Because when God wasn't working fast enough for Abraham and Sarah, and that promised son had not been born yet, Sarah and Abraham took things into their own hands and made a mess that we're still dealing with today. Because Sarah gave her servant Hagar to Abram as a wife, and she conceived and bore a son named Ishmael. And Ishmael was 13 years old when Isaac was born, and then that's when the problem at home started. Because up until then, Sarah had kind of adopted Isaac or Ishmael as her own son, but when she had Isaac, she was like, that son of that slave has no part. My son is your son. And so what did Abram do? He said, well, Sarah, whatever you want to do. And she kicked them out into the desert to go and die. And the Bible says that they took as much water as they could carry and some food. And when all of those supplies had run out, Hagar put Ishmael under a tree. And she went off a little ways because she didn't want to watch her son die. That's how bad it was. And in her crying and in her tears, she cried out to God. And God showed up and said, Hagar, I've heard your cry. And you're not going to die. As a matter of fact, I'm going to keep a promise. Because Ishmael is one of Abraham's sons, and he will be the father of great nations, many nations. And he is. Ishmael, Abraham's son, is the father of the descendants of the Arab nations. So when you think of Saudi Arabia, and you think of Iraq, and you think of Iran, and you think of Jordan, and you think of those Middle Eastern countries, why do they all want Israel? Because they say, hey, that was promised to us. And it's rightfully ours because we are the descendants of the firstborn son of Abram. We are the descendants of Ishmael, and that land is ours, and they are at war, and there will never be peace. There'll be 3.5 years of temporary peace, of an apparent peace that's not really a peace at all. But God promised them, Hagar and Ishmael, something, and God kept his promise. See, God's faithful. You can believe what God has promised in his word to you about today, about providing for you. Jesus made a promise in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33 that's still true for you and me today, and it's this: seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Paul was inspired to reveal that promise in a different way in Philippians chapter 4, verse 19, when he writes to the church at Philippi, and my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus, which is why what I read in Psalm 62 is still relevant for us today, because that is a reminder that we've got to keep our eyes on Jesus no matter what. We got to believe what Jesus says. We got to believe what the Bible says, because the world is going to tell us a whole lot of stuff that doesn't line up with what Jesus says, and we have to choose which we will believe. So I want to encourage you, and I want to remind you, believe Jesus, believe God's word. Why? Because he's never been wrong. And we can look at our politicians and we can say, have they ever been right? Right? We can look at our doctors and those that are doing, that work in the hospitals, and this is what they will tell you. They practice medicine. They haven't perfected it. They're practicing. And they love guinea pigs. Because that's what practice, right? They practice medicine. The doctors at Carolina Pines right now, the doctors at McLeod right now, the doctors at Duke right now, the doctors at NC Chapel Hill, in every hospital, in every office around the world, they're practicing medicine, right? Jesus never practiced anything in his life. He's done it. Well, let's go with the one who's always faithful and who's always right. I mean, over and over again, the world in every type of science has tried to prove that the Bible is wrong and that God is a liar. And every time they attempt to do that, they find something else, another evidence that proves that God's word is true. God's word is true. Think of the different promises about David. David's introduced, introduced in 1 Samuel chapter 16, which is before 1 Samuel 17, correct? That's the way it works, right? Well, you know what happens in 1 Samuel 17, right? It's the story of David and Goliath. David is anointed king in 1 Samuel 16. So David was promised the throne before he ever went to be a servant of Saul. Now, I don't know about you, but if I had been David, there would have been something that would have welled up in me that would have walked up to Saul and said, "You're sitting in my seat." Samuel, the prophet, God's man, just came and anointed me king. I'll give you 24 hours to pack up and move because I'm moving in. That's my seat. That's my house. I'm the king. I'm God's chosen one. That's not what David did. As a matter of fact, there were times that Saul was trying to kill him that David had the opportunity to end Saul's life, and he said, "I will not put my hand on God's anointing." You know what he was saying? God's faithful. And when God's ready, God will remove Saul and give me what he promised. So David waited and David trusted in the Lord. And it was years later before David was actually fully installed as the king of Israel. But you know what? God kept his promise. He always has, and he always will. We can go and we can talk about the northern kingdoms and the southern kingdoms, and as the nation of Israel was divided after Solomon died, and there was a whole train wreck of stuff and idolatry and paganness and wickedness. God would send prophets to his people, and they would preach, and the people would laugh and reject and kill them and do all kinds of horrible things. But in all of that, God was issuing and offering them a chance to repent with the promise of judgment if they didn't. And God gave them year after year for hundreds of years to repent, and they never did. And so what did God do? He kept his promise. And for the 10 northern tribes, the northern kingdom of Israel, he raised up the Assyrian empire. And we have the story of Jonah and the whale and Nineveh and all of that. That Nineveh was the capital of the Assyrian empire. And they came against the 10 northern tribes and defeated them and carried them away into slavery. Why? Because God said, "If you don't repent, I'm going to judge you and I will take you out." And God kept his words. And about 200 years later, God raised up the Babylonian empire and Nebuchadnezzar. And you got Daniel and Shadrach and Meshach and all of that stuff on the front end of that. Why? Because he had promised the same thing to the southern two tribes. And he gave them an extra 200 years to repent. And you know what? They wouldn't. And God kept his promise. And he judged them. And he took them into slavery, and they spent 70 years in a place that God didn't want them to spend. Why? Because they wouldn't live life God's way, and they wouldn't believe him. They wouldn't worship him. They wouldn't serve him. God kept his word. But in the midst of that judgment and all of that suffering and death and the horrible things that went on, God said, "I'll bring you home." And to the end of 70 years, God raised up a king, a Persian. And the Medo-Persian Empire overthrew the Babylonian Empire, and Cyrus the Great became king. And God had prophesied about Cyrus hundreds of years before he was born. And he said, I'm going to raise up a king of Persia, and I'm going to put it in his heart to send my people home. And God did. And you have the story of Ezra and Nehemiah and the rebuilding of the temple and the rebuilding of the city. And you have the story of Esther on the back end of all of that as it comes to fruition. And God sent his people home just like he promised. We jump forward about 450 years from that. Jesus is born. And he lives and he dies. And he makes promises to his disciples about being with them, about sending them out, that they would do greater things than even he did, and that the Holy Spirit would be with them, and that they would see the world, the nations come to Christ. And that's been happening. One conversation, one message, one bowing of the knee and the heart in repentance, seeking salvation and forgiveness for over 2,000 years. But in the midst of that, as Jesus ascended into heaven off of the Mount of Olives just outside of Jerusalem in sight of the temple, the disciples were standing there, 11 of them, and maybe some of the small crowd that was still following Jesus, and they watched Jesus ascend into heaven as he's speaking. But when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem right behind you, and in Judea right around you, and in Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. There's power that's going to come upon you, and you're going to go out, and with boldness you're going to proclaim, and people are going to turn to me, and they're going to be saved, and they're going to follow me all the days of their life. And they're standing, and Jesus disappears behind the clouds, and it's gone, and they just keep standing there looking up. And the Bible says this: some angels appeared to them and said, you men of Galilee, why are you standing here gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus that you just saw leave will one day come back just like he left. Why do we believe? Because God always, always keeps his promises. And he promised that one day he would come back. Why? John 14:6. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions or rooms. If it were not so, I would tell you that it's not so, but it is so. That's why I'm telling you that it's so. And I am leaving, and I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. And I will receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And Thomas said, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said, I am the way. That's a promise. That's a declaration, but that's a promise. I am the truth. That's a declaration, but that's a promise. I am the life. That's a declaration, but that's a promise. No man comes to the Father except by me. That's a declaration, but that's a promise, and it's coming true every day, because those who come to Christ are received. John writes, not everyone that hears believes. He came into his own, and his own did not receive him, but to them who did receive him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So we live with the future in mind, but we live today. And there are promises that God has made about the future, and we can believe them, and we can base our life on them. Why? Because God always keeps his promises. Amen. But he's called us to live today. And there are promises that he has made to give us all the wisdom that we need if we'll just ask. And there are promises that he will supply all of our needs if we will just put him first. If we will seek him first, then we won't have to worry about all the things that are going on in this world. We live in this world, but we're not of it. We live in this world, but we shouldn't be like it. Why? Because we keep our eyes on him, and we become more and more like him as we do that. Why believe? That's why. If you were wondering what to do in light of what you might be hearing on the news or reading on the internet or whatever, what do? You fix your eyes on Jesus, because he is our salvation. He is our rock. He is our present. And he is our future. And he cares for you. And when you worry, and when those anxieties rise up, what do? You do what the Bible says. You cast all your care, you cast all your worry, you cast all your anxiety on him. Why? Because he's promised he cares for you. Amen? So I want to encourage you, keep believing. Keep trusting, no matter what you see, no matter what you hear on the news, what you see happening on the streets, none of that stuff can change God's promises or his faithfulness. Trust in him. Today, with our heads bowed and eyes closed, Lynn's going to come and begin to play some music. And here's the reality. I want to give you just a moment, an opportunity to pray. You may be struggling. There may be some worry. There may be some anxiety. There may be some fear that's going on. There may be some doubt that rises up in your heart and in your mind because of all the things that are going on. Trust the Lord. Give those things to him. Give them to him again today and see what God will do. Father, I pray this morning that fear would have to flee because of faith. Lord, I believe that fear is faith in the enemy. Living in fear is a reality that we believe that the enemy is actually greater than you are, and yet the truth we know is completely different. The Bible says, greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. Jesus, that's you. You are in us, and you are greater. And I pray that our lives this week would reflect that truth, that promise. Lord, I pray that our conversations this week would reflect that reality, that you are faithful, that you keep your word. Lord, I love you. I believe that we love you and we trust you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. I hope you have a great week. Remember all the things that are going on this week, especially on Saturday with the prayer walk and that kind of stuff. Hope to see you on Wednesday nights. Our meals start back on Wednesday night, so if you want to eat on Wednesday night, make sure that you call and get on the list for this week as we start our Wednesday night meals back. God bless you. Have a great day.